Hello and welcome to the NPTEL MOOC course on Economics of Health and Education. In week 9 of this course, we will discuss about the status of health and education with particular reference to India. In the last 40 years, we have made much progress in the context of health status measurements and education status measurements. In today's class, we will focus on global disease burdens. And in respect to global disease burdens, I will start discussing about the very important and significant study referred to as the Global Burden of Disease Study, which began in the 1990s. So in this class, we will focus on the following. We will first study what is GBD study, what is the genesis of Global Burden of Disease Study. With respect to the GBD study, various country categorizations have been carried out to understand the disease patterns or the epidemiological patterns across different regions of the world. So we will understand what are these super regions or seven super regions as the GBD study refers to, and what are the important epidemiological patterns that are emerging from these super regions, and what relevance it has in the policy context. We will also study some of the key metrics of the Global Burden of Disease study, but most particularly we will focus on disability adjusted life years, which are an important metric that the GBD series uses, and it has come to tell us a lot about the disease burden across different countries. It is periodically calculated across a number of key parameters, so we will discuss DALYs. Then moving on from the explanation about disability adjusted life years and how it is measured, we will look at some of the patterns that are emerging with respect to DALYs in India based upon the 2021 data, which is the latest data available for DALYs based on the Global Disease Burden study. And then finally, we will look at what are the policy relevance of DALYs. So what is the GBD study? The GBD is the Global Burden of Disease Study, which is being published by Lancet, which is one of the world's oldest and prestigious medical journals, and it is one of the most comprehensive efforts to quantify global health trends. As I mentioned in the beginning of the class, that in the last 40 years, we have made much advancements with regard to health status measurements, and in the 1990s, when such studies began, nobody really imagined how these studies would progress in the next 40 years. But today we have very many global health trends that tell us a lot about the policy context of different countries across the world. So if you look at the origins of the Global Burden of Disease study, it began in the 1990s. And it was originally led by the World Bank in collaboration with the World Health Organization and the Harvard School of Public Health. And the primary focus of the GBD study was on providing a global picture of mortality and disability from major diseases, injuries and risk factors. The Lancet came in 2010, and since 2010, Lancet has been publishing the GBD study as a series, and this series has made it widely accessible, and it is influential in the global health community, which is used by practitioners and academicians to understand the health trends that are emerging, different emerging patterns in country contexts and so on. It is a very interesting study series which I would encourage learners to look up. Now, what is the scope and objective? It is a very comprehensive database that provides us assessment on burdens of diseases, injuries and risk factors globally as well as across countries and regions and over different periods of time. And as I mentioned, that metrics are some of the important, there are some important estimates that the Global Disease Burden study throws up, primarily being the disability adjusted life years. We will focus a little on DALYs in this class. And of course, in terms of comparisons, we have very rich comparisons across different diseases, risk factors, populations, and these different comparisons help us to identify different priority areas for health sector interventions. The data that is collected, that is used for the GBD, is from a vast array of sources. It includes the country-specific health surveys. For example, in India, we have National Family Health Survey, the demographic health surveys that is carried out in many country contexts, and it is a very important source of data for GBD studies. There are many hospital records, registries, and other demographic studies that also become a source of data for GBD. And it uses very sophisticated statistical modeling to estimate disease burden in cases where data are incomplete or missing. And needless to say, the GBD is of course a collaborative effort because it involves a large network of researchers and institutions globally, and it is being taken place in an unprecedented scale where today we have great access to quantifiable health related data from different countries. There is of course a huge policy influence with regard to the impact, because the findings from the GBD study series help us in shaping global health policies. Governments and non-governmental organizations, international organizations, academicians use the GBD data, and it is used for both policy as well as academic purposes for designing different health interventions at different levels of governance. It also has helped us in creating a lot of public awareness, because the data is publicly available, can be downloaded and used in different formats by different members of the public. So in that sense, it has created a lot of awareness with regard to health data and health information that is available at the tip of our fingers. Some of the recent updates with regard to the GBD study includes the emerging health threats that we are foreseeing in the future, as well as the emerging health threats, which includes the COVID-19. With regard to COVID-19 pandemic, there have been various analyses that have informed the policy making. It has also it is also looking at both direct effects and indirect effects of COVID-19, mortality, morbidity, disruptions to health services, the economic impact of COVID-19, and so on. It's rich in information and provides a lot of information to people who need health data for policy purposes. There are some criticisms and challenges of the GBD study also, particularly with respect to data quality and methodologies, because there are few countries that does not provide timely data. So there are issues with regard to accuracy of estimates. Then there are also methodological debates because of poor data availability, the statistical modelings that are carried out for coming up with the disease patterns for different countries. There are methodological debates. However, we can ignore for the time being some of these issues and focus on what are the best estimates that can be taken from the global disease burden study, and what does it have to tell us about the health status of our population. As I have already mentioned, that the data on GBD is publicly available. It is made available through the Institute for Health Metrics and Evaluation website, and it is freely available, so users can actually visit the website and explore the various interactive tools and data visualizations that the IHME website offers. Now, if you look at your the map on the slide here, this refers to the color codes. Shows the seven super regions that the GBD study considers, and these regions are based on epidemiological similarity, meaning the disease patterns with regard to the different sections of population or population specific disease patterns that are emerging. So which is what we are referring to as epidemiological similarity, geographic closeness, and socioeconomic characteristics. So the GBD study looks at different regions across the world and comes up with different kinds of disease patterns. And needless to say, when we look at different kinds of disease patterns with respect to regional classifications, it also tells us a lot about policy relevance, and also tells us a lot about different socioeconomic significance or implications of some of these findings. Now, what are these super regions, the seven super regions? The GBD basically divides the world into 21 regions, and these 21 regions are grouped into seven super regions. They are high income regions, which includes Australasia, high income Asia Pacific, for example, Japan, Western Europe, Southern Latin America, and high income North America, Canada, and so on. Second is Central Europe, Eastern Europe, and Central Asia, which includes Central Asia, Central Europe, and Eastern Europe. Then the third categorization is Latin America and the Caribbean. Sub-Saharan Africa is the fourth super region. North Africa and the Middle East is one region. South Asia, which includes India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Maldives, and so on. Then we have Southeast Asia, East Asia, and Oceania as the seventh region. So these regions are used to analyze health outcomes and risk factors, and they allow for comparisons within and between regions and facilitate a deeper understanding of global health trends. The grouping also helps us to account for differences in health systems across these different super regions. What is the level of economic development? What are the social determinants of health across these different regions in different parts of the world? Now, it is also interesting to note that based upon the global disease burden study, various similar epidemiological characteristics have been found in these individual countries categorized by different regions. So, for example, in the high income regions, some of the epidemiological characteristics as follows. There is a low burden of infectious diseases, and infectious diseases has been a marker of low income countries. So, the high income regions have a very noticeable low burden of infectious diseases, mostly due to advanced healthcare systems. Similarly, they also have high prevalence of non-communicable diseases or chronic diseases like heart disease, cancer, diabetes, and mental health disorders, which are some of the leading causes of morbidity and mortality. They also have an aging population, because these regions have the older populations and the life expectancy is much higher. And because of the aging population or older population, they contribute to very high rates of age-related conditions such as dementia and osteoporosis and so on. And because of high life expectancy, there is an aging population. So, life expectancy is among the highest globally in the high-income regions, which also contributes to the prevalence of chronic diseases in the high-income regions. If you look at the Central Europe, Eastern Europe, and Central Asia, these are some of the epidemiological characteristics. The health burden seems to be in transition. They are transitioning from infectious to NCDs, and the transition are some of the primary health concerns. So, transition meaning that there is an equally high burden of both infectious and non-communicable diseases. There are very high rates of cardiovascular diseases, which are mostly related to lifestyle factors. There is a substantially high burden of injuries due to road traffic accidents, occupational hazards, and so on. And there are also many alcohol-related health issues that have been identified for Central Europe, Eastern Europe, and Central Asia. If you look at the Latin American and Caribbean region, we refer to as dual burden of disease, which is also some kind of a transition from infectious to non-communicable diseases, but not exactly a transition, but very high rates of both infectious and rising non-communicable diseases. And infectious diseases are still present in very large numbers, like dengue, diarrheal diseases. They are public health concerns in this region. Due to rapid urbanization, there is also a prevalence of obesity, diabetes, and cardiovascular diseases. Violence and injuries have also been reported as contributing significantly to the overall disease burden in Latin America and the Caribbean. Sub-Saharan Africa, some of the epidemiological characteristics are a high burden of infectious diseases such as HIV, AIDS, malaria, and tuberculosis. There are many childhood diseases which are mostly due to malnourishment, infectious diseases. There is poor access to healthcare. There is also an emerging non-communicable disease. There is a growing burden of hypertension, diabetes, which is seen to be more particularly affecting the urban areas. And there are also maternal and neonatal health issues, which mostly is due to limited access to quality health care. In the context of North Africa and the Middle East, these are some of the characteristics. There is an epidemiological transition. They are transitioning from infectious to NCDs. But there is a very high burden of NCDs, injuries, and violence. Respiratory diseases such as chronic obstructive pulmonary disease and asthma due to air pollution or high levels of air pollution have also been noticed. If you see in the context of South Asia, like the Latin America and the Caribbean, a very high burden of infectious diseases is noticed, particularly in the context of tuberculosis and diarrheal diseases, respiratory infections. There is also an emerging NCD burden, because of which in the context of South Asia also, like in the context of Latin America and Caribbean, we refer to the dual burden of disease. Dual burden of disease meaning burden of both communicable and non-communicable diseases being high. And you would see that these epidemiological characteristics contrast sharply with that of the high income countries that we observed in the first case, where we did not see much incidence of infectious diseases. Malnutrition and maternal health is one of the important epidemiological characteristics for South Asia, and there are of course environmental concerns of poor air quality, unsafe water, which contribute to a high burden of respiratory and diarrheal diseases. So, an overview of the epidemiological characteristics of these regions also gives us a sense of the socioeconomic development, or what are the social determinants of health in these regions, and therefore the connection that is established between epidemiological patterns and the overall economic development of a country. Southeast Asia, East Asia and Oceania have diverse health challenges. NCDs are an important burden in these countries as well. There is a very high burden of respiratory and infectious diseases. There is rapidly increasing NCDs, and there is of course an impact of aging population as well. Although Japan is included and South Korea is included in the high income countries, they can also be considered as East Asian countries, which has seen a rapidly increasing NCDs because of a highly aging population. So, as I was mentioning, that one of the important conclusions to be drawn from the global burden of disease is the country classification, the region classification, and that has given us an overview of what are the different epidemiological patterns that are emerging from these different regions, and it also gives us a global overview of how different populations are performing with respect to different disease burdens. Now, in the context of GBD, or the Global Burden of Disease Study, metrics play an important role, because here we are estimating the disease burden, and it is appropriate that we have a discussion into what is disease burden really and how it contrasts with the concepts of prevalence and incidence. So, GBD study uses several key metrics, but one of the primary metric is what is referred to as disability adjusted life years. And disability adjusted life years basically tells us the total number of years which is lost due to illness, disability or premature death. So, it basically combines two important components of health status. One is mortality and the other is morbidity. So, in the context of mortality, we are basically talking about premature death, and premature death is of course not desirable. It has a huge impact on the productivity of a country. But similarly, morbidity, or the condition of being sick, also impacts productivity. So, mortality, of course, there is cessation of life, and that impacts the overall productivity of a country. But if a population also is facing morbidity or morbid symptoms, then that also directly impacts the number of hours that you can give in for work, and that obviously impacts your productivity. So, disability adjusted life years calculates two important components. One is the years of life lost, which is basically mortality, and the second is years lived with disability or morbidity. So, both of these together tells us what is the status of health of a population in a country context, or in different country contexts with based upon global comparisons. So, this is a calculation of disease burden, but we also contrast it with the concepts of prevalence of a disease or incidence of a disease. And usually in country context, for example, in India, we often based upon nationally representative sample surveys like the National Sample Survey Organization or the National Statistical Office, we often calculate prevalence or incidence. prevalence refers to the total number of cases of a disease or condition at a given time. So what is the prevalence of disease, or what are the numbers of different diseases that are prevalent in a given period of time? But incidence refers to the number of new cases occurring within a specified period. So the prevalence and incidence of a disease also gives us some indication with regard to what is the disease pattern in a country or a location. It could be at a subnational level like districts. We could also calculate it at a village level or a town level and so on. Different levels of disaggregation can be carried out. But the burden of disease gives us an overview of how many years of life we have lost because of premature death, or because of facing disability adjusted life years, or because of facing morbidity conditions. So in that sense, the concept of disability adjusted life year is very important as a metric for determining disease burden. Now, before we move on to how DALYs or disability adjusted life years are calculated, we must also see how GBD study gathers data. What are the different sources from which it gathers data? The vital registration systems of different countries are an important source of data for the GBD study, which includes national and subnational death registries because they provide data on mortality rates and causes of death. Different health surveys, I have already mentioned that population-based surveys in the Indian context, for example, NFHS or the DHS surveys are important sources of data. It is also available in the Global Health Observatory that can be accessed publicly by researchers and members of the public. They provide data on prevalence and incidence of various health conditions and the risk factors associated. Hospital records and administrative data is an important source of information. Now, in the developing country context, there is often a lot of emphasis on whether hospitals are maintaining their records or not, or whether administrative data is regularly available. For example, we are lagging behind with respect to census data in India, which is a very important source of information for studies such as the Global Burden of Disease study, because it gives us a lot of population related information, and disease patterns need to be adjusted for population sizes and both by gender and the composition with respect to regional differences. So hospital records and administrative data is an important source of data for GBD studies. Epidemiological studies carried by various scholars, published and unpublished, which provide data on disease prevalence, incidence and risk factors, are an important source. And cause of death data is also obtained from death certificates, autopsies and other sources, which are then categorized using the International Classification of Diseases, which becomes an important reference point for the GBD study. Various data processing and modeling techniques are employed for GBD data analysis. A lot of standardization of data takes place depending upon differences in definitions, measurement techniques and population structures. Various codes are used for example, the cause of death modeling is used for mortality estimates. There are for estimating incidence and prevalence and mortality for non-fatal conditions, various kinds of approaches are used. There are many socioeconomic status variables and environmental factor variables that are also used to refine estimates and account for differences in health outcomes across populations. And without going into the details of some of these analysis, it will suffice to say that many kinds of sensitivity analysis and uncertainty analysis are carried out to provide quantifiable data on health status. These are some of the reasons that makes Global Burden of Disease study reliable and robust and amenable for use by the general public or by academicians, researchers and policy makers at large. Now, there are different ways in which the GBD results are presented. There are presentations are based upon global, regional and national estimates. There are various visualization tools that can be used by country, by year, by age group and sex. And towards the end of today's lesson, we will see some of the visualizations in the context of India and how remarkable they are in terms of the interpretations that we can have with regard to policy interventions or health interventions that need to be carried out in the Indian context. Now, let me take you through a hypothetical illustration of how DALIs are calculated. So, I have discussed so far that disability adjusted life years are an important metric for estimating global disease burden. And this is an important metric because it considers two important components, which is mortality and morbidity in calculating, in giving us an estimate of global disease burden. Mortality meaning the years of life lost, and the morbidity basically tells us how many years people are living by adjusting to disability. So, what is the disability status? The disability could be because of any disease. Here I have considered diabetes, type 2 diabetes, as a condition. It's a hypothetical illustration. The first step is to define the population and the disease type. So, understand that the DALIs are calculated for each disease and for each country. So, you can imagine the scale of the estimations that are carried out based upon the global burden disease. Of course, various statistical tools and techniques and softwares are used to calculate these, but it is useful to look at what is the importance of this calculation. So, in step 1, we first define the population and the condition. In this case, we have taken a hypothetical condition of type 2 diabetes, and a population is, let us say, of some country X, and time frame is 1 year. In step 2, we first calculate the years of life lost. Basically, we want to quantify the burden of premature mortality or people who have died because of this condition prematurely. And we calculate this by summing the differences between the standard life expectancy and age at death for all deaths due to the condition. But in this case, we have considered type 2 diabetes. So, let us determine the number of deaths due to type 2 diabetes. So, in country X, let us say during the year of study, there were 1000 deaths due to type 2 diabetes. Now, after estimating the number of deaths because of the disease, we will estimate the age at death for each individual, or the average age at death because of type 2 diabetes. Now, let us assume that the average age of death for these individuals was 65 years. And now, we will determine the standard life expectancy. So, if they were alive, they would have been alive under normal conditions up to how many years? And in this case, the GBD often uses a global standard life expectancy at birth, which is around 86 years for both sexes, male and female. So, we have 1000 deaths due to type 2 diabetes. We have also estimated the age at death. We have taken the average age of death for these individuals as 65 years. And we have taken a standard life expectancy measure, which is about 86 years for both sexes. So, with this information, we then calculate the years of life lost for each individual. The YLL for each death is basically the difference between standard life expectancy and age at death. We know the standard life expectancy is 86 years and age at death is 65 years. So, YLL per individual is 21 years. And then based upon this, we calculate the total YLLs, because we know that there have been 1000 deaths. So, total YLLs is 1000 deaths into 21 years. That means 21,000 years have been lost because of premature death due to type 2 diabetes in country X in 1 year. Now, in step 3, we want to estimate the burden of morbidity in the population. So, morbidity meaning the condition of feeling sick or being in a sick state for a period of time. And in this case, we have considered 1 year as the period of time. So, we calculate the years lived with disability. So, first we determine the prevalence. In this case, prevalence of type 2 diabetes. Let us assume that in country X, 50,000 people are living with type 2 diabetes. So, we have already seen 1,000 people have died of type 2 diabetes. But in this period, there are 50,000 people who are living with type 2 diabetes. Then we estimate the disability weight for type 2 diabetes. There is an elaborate method by which different diseases are given a disability weight. And these weights are assigned based on the severity of the condition. So, without going to the details of how the disability weights are assigned, Let us assume here that, for example, type 2 diabetes might have a disability weight of 0.15, where 0 represents perfect health and 1 represents death. So, between 0 and 1, let us say type 2 diabetes has a disability weight of 0.15. So, with this information, we then calculate the years lived with disability, which is prevalence multiplied by disability weight. We already know that 50,000 people are living with diabetes and the disability weight is 0.5. So, with this information, we calculate that 7,500 years lived with disability is calculated. And we DALYS is basically the measure of mortality plus morbidity. So, we basically sum up the YLLs and YLDs, which represents the total burden of disease. So, in the next step, we calculate the total DALYS by summing up the YLLs and YLDs that we have calculated. So, that gives us 21,000 YLLs that we had calculated in the last case here, where we calculated total YLLs as 21,000. And the YLDs are 7,500. So, we sum up YLLs and YLDs to get 28,500 disability adjusted life years. So, we have incorporated both the mortality measure and the morbidity measure to come up with DALYS. So, how do we interpret this result of DALYS? This is basically saying that 28,500 disability adjusted life years in country X due to type 2 diabetes, which means that the disease has caused a total burden equivalent to 28,500 years lost due to either premature death or living with disability. So, if 28,500 years have been lost in 1 year because of premature death or disability, then one can again have further calculations with regard to what is the loss of productivity or what is the negative impact such years of life lost has on the GDP or growth of a country. So, therefore, the global burden of disease has a direct connection with how we want to understand the levels of development and growth within a country. And of course, one also has to talk about well-being of population from the social justice lens point of view. But if we have to talk about it in a very narrow sense of the term, the calculation of DALYS gives us a sense of how much we have lost in terms of output within the economy. Now, let me take you through to some of the DALYS in the context of India, which I found very interesting, and I have downloaded these from the website on the Global Burden Disease Study. This figure here shows you the top 10 causes of DALYS in India for the period 2021. Now, DALYS are periodically calculated based upon the GBD study. The recent data for which we have information on DALYS is for 2021, and this was the period of COVID deaths worldwide as well as in India. Now, if you look at this figure here, this chart actually categorizes DALYS into 3 groups. You have the greens, which gives us communicable, maternal, perinatal and nutritional conditions. So, basically these conditions are significant in lower income settings and represent ongoing global health challenges. The blues are non-communicable diseases, and when we saw epidemiological characteristics across the 7 super regions of the world, we saw that these actually dominate in higher income settings. But in the context of lower income settings or other countries also, we have seen emerging non-communicable diseases along with a high burden of infectious diseases. The dark blues are the category injuries. Now, if you look at this figure here, this figure shows that because this figure is for 2021, so needless to say, COVID-19 tops the chart of disability adjusted life year, the top cause of DALY. For Indian population. This one is for all ages across male and female. So, this is a total DALYS in India for all ages. The horizontal axis, the x-axis shows us DALYS per 100,000 population, and the y-axis shows us the different disease types. COVID-19 stands out as the leading cause of DALYS, which is significantly higher than other conditions in 2021. So this basically reflects the impact of COVID-19 pandemic, which caused both high morbidity and mortality. So which means that this is not just deaths from COVID-19, but people feeling sick or being in a morbid state because of COVID-19 or having faced mortality because of COVID-19. So that tells us the overall status of population because of the COVID-19 disease. Then we have NCDs, ischemic heart disease, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and preterm birth conditions, which will come under communicable diseases. But NCDs are some of the prominent among the top causes, which highlights India's burden of cardiovascular diseases. And these conditions are major contributors to mortality and long-term disability. COPD or chronic obstructive pulmonary disease and diabetes mellitus are also significant contributors to DALYs, which reflects the growing burden of chronic diseases. If you see, back and neck pain is also appearing as one of the top 10 causes of DALY, which tells us that occupational health hazards, or it emphasizes the importance of musculoskeletal disorders, which contribute to disability. Although they are less likely to cause death, but the fact remains that if there are these morbid conditions within the population in India. Communicable diseases appear as one of the important top 10 diseases. If you look at diarrheal diseases, tuberculosis, lower respiratory infections, these conditions reflect the ongoing burden of communicable diseases. India being a low income country compared to the other six super regions or the high income countries, the incidence of infectious diseases is very high. Now, each of these diseases also have implications for public health policy, needless to say, because depending upon the kind of disease burden that we see, there are conclusions that need to be drawn with regard to what are the different kinds of health interventions that need to be carried out. So we'll focus a little on what is the policy relevance of this. Let us move on and look at the next figure here. This one tells us about the top 10 causes of DALYs in India, all ages, female. And you don't see much of a difference between what we saw for all ages, for all total population and female. But if you look at the figure for top 10 causes of DALYs for male, you will see that road injuries appears as one of the major causes among the top 10 causes of DALY, which also tells us a lot about socioeconomic characteristics and the stage of development that we are in, and how that impacts the health status of population. So therefore, we talk about epidemiological patterns, which basically connects disease patterns with the population status of the country. Cirrhosis of the liver has been identified as one of the top 10 causes as far as male health is concerned in India, based upon 2021 data. I have also put together data on DALYs for ages 1 to 4, which is the infant population in the country, and you would see that immediately the pattern of diseases change compared to the all India population. You will see that iron deficiency, anemia, diarrheal diseases, lower respiratory infections appear as some of the top 10 causes. Drowning appears as also as one of the important causes of DALYs with respect to ages 1 to 4. Which has a lot of relevance in the context of surroundings within which Indian population exists. Skin diseases, protein energy malnutrition, congenital anomalies, preterm birth complications, these all fall largely within non-communicable diseases and injuries. So in the context of countries such as India, when we talk about dual burden of diseases, this is what we mean, that while certain sections of the population, like the aging population or older sections of the population, have moved towards more lifestyle diseases, among the majority of 0 to 4 population or 1 to 4 population, we still see a dominance of communicable diseases, which can be controlled by health interventions, adequate health interventions at different levels of governance, including community level and the household level. Similarly, if you look at the female population, For ages 1 to 4, the top 10 causes of Delhi are again communicable diseases. The green bars are much bigger. In fact, in all the 10 diseases that we see, except congenital anomalies, drowning and skin diseases, the rest are communicable diseases in the list. If you look at the, it is interesting to see how the slightly older age children disease patterns are showing up in India. This is the figure for ages 10 to 14 Dallys in India. You will see that there is an equivalent number of communicable and non-communicable diseases. Now, what are the non-communicable diseases that show up? There are childhood behavioral disorders. Migraine is appearing as one of the important disease that impacts children in the age group of 10 to 14, which also points to various kinds of socioeconomic and environmental factors that contribute to disease patterns. Communicable diseases like iron deficiency anemia, diarrheal diseases continue to be bear the top spots. Similarly, in country contexts, while there has been a lot of emphasis on diseases such as COVID-19 being some of the infectious diseases, you would see that irrespective of COVID-19, countries such as India have been suffering from diarrheal diseases, and tuberculosis is one of the important diseases that requires a lot of policy attention. So while the world has moved towards looking at diseases such as COVID-19 because it was a pandemic and it impacts large sections of population, but for countries such as India, there is still a lot of relevance of policy relevance with respect to more viral infectious diseases such as diarrheal diseases or tuberculosis. Now, if you look at ages 15 to 19, again, some interesting pattern comes up. Self-harm is one of the top contributors to disability adjusted life years. So, loss of life due to self-harm or morbidity conditions because of self-harm contributes to one of the important causes of disease patterns in the ages 15 to 19, which requires various kinds of policy attention, both in educational institutions, in the social conditioning of how young population in the age group of 15 to 19 are being socialized and so on and so forth. Road injuries are an important cause of Dallys in this case. Again, in the case of 15 to 19 age group, you will see that there are an equivalent number of green bars, blue bars and the dark blue bars. So, which means that it is a concern with regard to both communicable and non-communicable disease. But the nature of non-communicable disease such as self-harm or depressive disorders, road injuries, migraines, back and neck pain, which refers to postural conditions or refers to different kinds of musculoskeletal problems within the population, also deserves attention. Now, just to contrast between the very young age population and the old age population, because population in India is also aging, I have put together figures for Dallys in the age group of 70 to 74. The disease patterns immediately change here. You will see more blue bars here. So, there are more non-communicable diseases and injuries that lead to morbidity and mortality in this population. Heart diseases, pulmonary diseases, strokes, but at the same time, communicable diseases such as diarrheal diseases or lower respiratory infections seems to be impacting population in countries such as India across age groups. So, therefore, that requires a more comprehensive health intervention at the country level. So, as I was saying that Dallys are an important metric in the global burden of disease study, and it provides us various kinds of disease patterns across different countries, and it tells us it has a lot of policy relevance. So, let us look at some of the policy relevance which has relevance for public policy formulation. One is that Dallys provide us a comprehensive measurement of health burdens, and that is an important characteristic of calculation of Dallys, and a calculation of Dallys for so many different diseases based upon the international classification of diseases. Here here we have just seen some of the top 10 causes of dialysis, but these are calculated by different diseases for different countries. So that gives us a sense of the scale at which such data is available currently. Now it combines both mortality and morbidity data because it is based upon YLLs or years of life lost due to premature death and years lived with disability. So it provides a single and comprehensive measure of both mortality and morbidity, and this helps policymakers understand the full impact of a health condition beyond just mortality statistics. So it, in a true sense of the term, it gives us the health status of the population. And that helps us to prioritize on health issues because we can then identify the diseases and conditions that contribute the most to overall disease burden. Like in the context of India, we have seen that diarrheal diseases or communicable diseases seem to be impacting all sections of the population. So then in that sense, a more comprehensive policy intervention needs to take place with regard to the disease burden. So, policymakers can prioritize interventions, research and funding to address the most significant health challenges. Secondly, DALIs provide us evidence-based decision-making opportunities because we can then use the objective data for policy development. They offer an objective and quantitative basis for policy decisions. So, it allows governments to compare the burden of various health conditions and allocate resources to areas where we need to achieve the greatest health improvements. So, because we, the basic idea in economics that resources are scarce and we need to have efficient utilization of resources or allocation of resources means that if we have such patterns of global health burdens or country level disease burdens, then it can allow policymakers to then decide or prioritize which are the health interventions that need to be carried on for which sections of the population. Targeting intervention is an important policy area that DALIs help us to do because it helps us to identify the population that is at risk. We can highlight specific populations or regions within a country that are disproportionately affected by certain disease. Like in the context of 15 to 19 age group, we have just seen that self-harm tops the list of DALIs. So this is a cause of death or morbidity which requires a different kind of an approach. Simply having an health intervention will not solve the problem of self-harm among the ages of 15 to 19 years old. So probably it requires a more comprehensive approach by including both educational institutions and the society at large to understand what kind of policy interventions take place. So this information of identifying the at-risk population is very crucial for designing targeted interventions that address health disparities. It also helps us to prioritize preventive measures because then we can understand the burden of disease allows for prioritization of preventive measures. For instance, if NCDs like heart disease and diabetes contribute significantly to DALIs, then policies may actually focus on lifestyle interventions such as promoting physical activity, health diets. So comprehensive primary healthcare packages can actually constitute different kinds of efficiency enhancing measures such as physical activities within the comprehensive primary healthcare packages. Monitoring and evaluation is an important policy formulation that comes about because of such studies. We can track progress. DALIs can be used to monitor the impact of health policies and programs over time. And a reduction in DALIs from a specific disease will basically indicate whether the intervention has been effective or not. And but an increase in DALIs may actually signal that we need to adjust our policies to ensure that the DALIs come down. It helps us to set targets. Policymakers can then set specific targets for reducing DALIs as a part of national health goals. National health policies can then prioritize on certain health diseases, on certain disease patterns, so that it impacts productivity at large. For example, in India, there has been a lot of focus on reproductive and child diseases. So a country might aim to reduce DALIs associated with childhood diseases by a certain percentage over a decade. And these are realistic targets that have been taken up in the context of developing countries like India. Similarly, we can address health inequalities. DALIs can reveal health inequalities between different demographic groups such as age, gender, socioeconomic status or geographic location, and this can enable policymakers to develop targeted strategies to reduce disparities. And of course, as we have seen, DALIs can help us to compare globally health statuses, and that also gives us a lot of insights into how we have progressed vis-a-vis the other countries, and then the best practices from different countries can also be aligned to ensure that the country lags are diminished. There are many economic considerations of calculation of DALIs. First is that it is a cost-effective analysis. DALIs are used in cost-effectiveness analysis to compare benefits of different health interventions. Policymakers can use this analysis to decide which interventions provide the greatest health benefit for the least cost, and optimizing the use of public funds. It has an impact on workforce, because high DALIs from conditions affecting working age population can have significant economic consequences. So policies aimed at reducing DALIs in this demographic can help maintain a healthy and productive workforce. DALIs can also help us to respond to emerging health threats, for example, pandemic preparedness and response. DALIs provide a framework for understanding the impact of emerging health threats. Similarly, health system resilience also depends upon calculation of DALIs. When we understand the burden of disease through DALIs, it can help us in designing different resilient health systems so that their systems can respond quickly and effectively to ongoing health challenges and emerging new disease patterns. So, in a way, we could say that the disability adjusted life years metric are a crucial tool for policymakers, because it offers a detailed understanding of the health challenges facing a population. It provides a comprehensive measure of both mortality and morbidity associated with diseases, and it helps to ensure that health policies are data driven, targeted, and effective in improving population health outcomes. They facilitate the efficient allocation of resources, monitoring of health interventions, promotion of health equity, and all of these are essential for development of effective national health strategies. So in today's class, we have been introduced to the global burden of disease study. We saw how global burden of disease study, what is the scope and coverage of these studies, the importance and significance of looking at disease burdens, how it tells us about or informs us about the health status of population. We looked closely at the important metric of disability adjusted life years. We saw how to calculate the DALIs and how DALIs incorporates both mortality and morbidity concept to give us a comprehensive measure of health status of a population. We looked at some of the top reasons of DALIs by disease burden in the context of India. We saw how different sections of the population, the very young age population, older age population, suffer from different disease types. And then finally, we also saw what is the policy relevance of looking at DALIs. I hope this class would help the learners to understand the importance of looking at health status and how different measures help us to compare different countries as well as different states within a country and the policy relevance it has. I have used the following materials for this class. There have been some Lancet studies on global burden of disease and risk factors that I have used for this class. And there are a few critical websites that I have referred to, the lancet.com. Then there are mortality and global health estimates and the leading causes of DALIs. The figures I have downloaded from the website of the WHO, where there are many visualizations that can be seen by the learners. You can also try at looking at some of the data, which gives us a very interesting overview of DALIs across many countries. I have only picked up India for the sake of our class. And then I have also looked at some of the research analysis on GBD from the website healthdata.org. So with this, I will see you in the next class. Thank you.